I there's a similar situation in Dark Souls 3 with the fire shrine maiden. You know, she repeats a lot of options, and I definitely felt like more invested in her as a character. Maybe she, because she said less. Right. I don't know. How do you feel like towards the doll in Bloodborne? Oh, sure. Gotcha. If anyone is ever curious about whether or not Yahtzee and I just talk about Dark Souls in our free time, the answer is absolutely. I can hear you. Hold on, let me. No, you are not coming through the stream. Hi, everybody. Yes, Yahtzee and I were discussing the doll and Fire Link Maiden characters in Dark Souls and Bloodborne, and specifically the one from Dark Souls 2. Bearer, seek, seek. Bearer, sink, seek, seek, sink, seek, seek. So hi everybody. I'll say hi to Besmarch. Thanks for that $5 American, who says afternoon, gentlemen. Have some loot. I will take
How's
that loot.
this? Can you hear me now? Can you
You are
hear?
coming through the stream now.
All right. Just had to change my device settings on XSplit. I don't know why. Never had to do that before.
It's a brave new world.
I guess.
And E1 Crazy for Life, thanks for the $10 American. We appreciate that support. Who says Honey Pop 2 just came out on Steam this week? Don't worry about reviewing that game, Yahtzee. I'm planning to make my own ZP style review of that game, like I did with the first game.
A lot of people keep bringing up those dumb Japanese porn games. I am never going to review them. Because they're porn.
Because they're oh, that's why. That makes a lot of sense, yeah.
Anyway, we're playing the medium.
You're playing The Medium, which is a game that I have heard so much about.
What have you heard about it?
I've heard it's okay, not the best, but an interesting graphical experience.
Have you heard that it's by Bloober Team, the creators of numerous walking simulators such as Layers of Fear and Blair Witch?
I think I knew they made Blair Witch, yes.
Have you heard that it's also directly inspired by Silent Hill, to the point of featuring music by Akira Yamaoka, the composer of Silent Hill?
Interesting. And you know what? I unfortunately did not have time this morning to watch your review of it. So does that mean that you absolutely loved it?
Hardly.
Okay.
Okay, I'm hearing the game audio on my TV. Is it coming across on the stream?
No, it is not.
Man, everything's going to shit today.
It is, but that will give me time to thank Philip McCarlraft for the $5 American who says, "Why aborted baby monster movie?" Speak that's a question about for me asking about a movie we watched on Best of the Worst, because we watch bad movies, and bad movies usually have extreme attention-grabbing premises. Premise. However you pluralize premise.
Still on the TV. What is going on? Hang on, hang on.
Okay.
I'm gonna start the game again.
Okay, Yancey's gonna start the game again.
See, all my other system sound is coming through my headset like it's supposed to, but not the game. Why is that? Why? How? What possible arrangement would cause that?
Was there like a recent update to XSplit and it just miffed everything up?
I don't think so.
Oh, because that happened to me recently with OBS. I use OBS to stream, and the Escapists movie podcast stream live completely borked all of our audio, so we were running like 10 minutes late while I had to like fix everything. The cold has gotten to Jack's brain. It is very cold in Wisconsin. Today was -5, but it felt like -12. So there you go. You need to convert Yahtzee to the joys of OBS. It's a horse apiece, XSplit or OBS. I feel like whatever you use more is the correct way because the more you use something, the better you know it. I know OBS fairly well.
It's still only coming out of my TV. What the hell? Hang on.
No problem, Yahtzee.
Oh, the game has its own audio setting. Who does that?
What?
The game has its own
I'm
audio
seeing.
settings.
You set the output through the game? That's weird.
There
That's
we go.
unusual, yes.
Now I can hear it. Remains to be seen if the stream can hear it.
All right, hold on. Let me turn on the audio. Yes, it is coming through now. You got it.
Seriously, guys, who does that?
Blooper team.
Fucking blooper team. Well, you're off to a bad start.
Yeah. Boom.
You're missing all the amazing dramatic action of this moment.
Oh no. It looks like she's a ghost. No, she's someone who was being murdered. She's not, she's a pre-ghost.
Well, that was all a dream. I'll give
Oh.
that away.
Never mind.
That was a dream that someone was having.
Oh.
Ever since I was little,
Great.
I've had this
Daniel
strange.
Timokin, thanks for the $5
Escapist
Canadian, who says, why does the character in
Carl
the thumbnail look
Reiner
like
was
Jesse from Control,
the
but
only
she was
one
related to Dante from Devil May
escaped?
Cry?
I feel like that's sort of the generic look
Revenge.
for female protagonists in video games these days. She kind of looks a bit like what's her name from The Last of Us 2 as well.
Like Ellie?
Yeah, like dark brown hair, worried face, haircut that's girlish but not long.
Sure. Yeah, you know who else she reminds me of is Jyn Erso
Oh yeah.
from Rogue One.
Yeah, that really does seem to be like generic female protagonist look these days.
Right? It's like but you're correct where it's like strong girl female
Yeah,
protagonist.
strong,
Yeah.
the strong girl look.
Yeah. Interesting. I wonder like what focus group testing led them to like short, pulled back, dark hair, worried face.
Yeah, and sort of gender neutral clothes.
That day from
There's, they,
home,
there is, there's always seemed to be a sort of element of gender
it was
neutrality
the
about
hardest
them,
day
despite
of
being
my
girls.
You know, that's like action outfit.
Say goodbye to my father.
Right, I
You
guess.
know, that's it's fine. You know, leather jacket, jeans, put that on anyone. That's fine. I'm okay with that.
DMA Stripolito on Twitch asked if there are any blonde strong female protagonists. None spring immediately to mind.
You know, I think if you go into like action movie schlock, you have like Charlize Theron
Oh, some people
in like
mentioning
that.
Samus Aran.
Oh, there you
But she
go.
usually wears a helmet, so I'm not
Yeah.
sure that should count.
Pull myself
Doesn't
together.
count. Doesn't count. But yeah, like Uma Thurman, Charlize Theron, Cynthia Rothrock. Any old school kung fu fans out there? I think there are plenty, but there does seem to be a modern
I
trend
was
as far
almost
as when it
right.
comes to like
I just had to find his special
not,
fight clip.
I don't know. I don't know how to put it.
Yeah, as we say, it's a modern trend. I was thinking back to like video games with prominent female protagonists.
Yeah.
I guess what's her name from Horizon Zero Dawn doesn't really.
Oh, yeah, that's a
did
good
that.
mold breaker.
Yeah.
Aloy with her red dreadlocks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
But thinking about it, even like Alex from Half-Life 2 sort of follows
Nice
that
to see you
template.
too.
Sure.
Short yet female hairstyle, dark brown hair, gender neutral clothing.
Like he never.
Ooh, but and someone is mentioning Total Recall, and it's like Sharon Stone, that's like, femme fatale blonde.
Was I
Yeah,
home?
it's probably just kind of like against the blonde bombshell stereotype is all that they're hoping for here. It's like blonde is girly,
Jack was he
bombshell, we
part of
are
the
dark hair.
solidarity movement?
We are
Is that a
not
thing that's
over
happening?
sexualizing our female character.
Keep pissing at me.
So one of the ways the medium is trying
Guess
to
I'll watch you
evoke
next.
retro survival horror like Silent Hill is its use of fixed third-person cameras, as you might have
I used to think I'd
noticed.
never fit in.
I am
Jack,
noticing that. Well,
Jack,
I guess
oh
you're
my.
just in the one room, so it hasn't really kicked in for me.
Right. At this point, I was sort of more reminded of point-and-click adventure games, or the way they started being when 3D graphics started becoming a thing, like Grim Fandango and
Yeah.
a couple of other ones, when they're thinking about navigating like 3D environments with a 3D character with like slightly awkward tank controls.
Yeah, that's I see you bumping into walls and everything right now.
Yeah. So
Yeah.
I hadn't heard this game was inspired by Silent Hill. I was quite a ways into it before I got any sort of vibe along those lines.
Oh.
Because it made me just. So that mainly just thought of
Looks
adventure games.
nourishing.
Yeah. Yeah, it definitely has an adventure gamey vibe so far where you're just rubbing up against things and examining them.
Yeah.
It's all still here.
That's going to be most of the gameplay. It's like
Oh.
looking for things, look to open up the next area, very survival horror-y sort of way.
Sure.
Find the key that goes in the log.
Oh no. I mean it looks good. Everything looks very pretty.
Yeah, looks kind of nice. Don't know how to spell illuminate, but it looks nice.
Oh.
It's
I wouldn't have
what?
caught that either.
It's two L's.
That's your department, not me.
We should stress this is a Polish game
Oh,
made by
okay.
Polish people. And it's actually set in Poland, even though everyone's talking English and American accents. In fact,
Oh.
like Polish politics becomes a big part of the plot later on.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's kind of fun. Katob Ulpass Decision. Thanks for the $5, American, who says, I am curious your take on this game. I'm calling it the whole game a horror game for the faint of heart. Oh, a horror game for the faint of heart. And so, like, what, at the end of the day, did you give this a thumbs up or a thumbs down?
I kind of gave it
This one.
a thumbs in the middle, leaning downwards after the ending.
Oh, okay.
It didn't have a very good ending, I'm afraid.
Oh.
I don't think it would be too much of a spoiler to say it ends with gunshot for cut to black.
Oh no, why? Why would you do such a thing?
And
That's the worst.
I'd remember the old previously recorded video you guys did on The Order 1886, which is another game that ends with gunshot cut to black.
Son of a bitch. That is like the tritest art house trope. The gun is pointing at someone. It cuts to black. You hear the gunshot and
Yeah.
know the deed was done. Fuck that.
Well, that's the annoying thing, is because you don't know if the specific deed was done. Because the final moment of the game is a choice between two things getting shot. And you never know which of the two things gets shot. It's
Oh,
just
come
gunshot
on.
cut to black and then credits.
Come on, get out of
I need to actually
town.
absorb these instructions. 5 seconds, okay. One, two, three, four, five.
You did it! Congratulations! Hey, Asti Foo, thanks for that $10, American, who says, Yahtzee, it seems there was another in the Remnant series released last year by Gunfire Games. It's called Chronos Before the Ashes, and it's a prequel. I kind of hate it. Have you seen it?
I have not.
Well, there you go.
I didn't get back to DLC, as you know.
Oh, it was DLC.
I don't know, was it?
Oh, I don't.
I just know I hadn't heard of it.
They said that it was just another Remnant series, so I don't know if it was DLC. Jeff Bezos, what's he doing there?
Or Kevin Spacey as Lex Luthor.
Ooh, or Agent 47.
Yeah, it's a full character's name here.
Nah.
Yeah, see, Krakow.
Oh,
Krakow, which is
good morning, Krakow.
in Poland, of course.
Here we
Yeah.
go. What's your
Yeah,
favorite
it looks great.
food?
Everything
Let's see
looks
what's
beautiful.
cooking around.
Just down to feed this cat.
Oh, nice. I'm just gonna feed this cat. Felix Lang, thanks for the £4.99, who says a lot of female characters have a short, under-sexualized look now. Shell from Portal comes to mind, the one game nobody hates.
They kind of sexed her up a bit in the sequel. They
Did they
suddenly
sex her
the
up?
a little bit because the orange jumpsuit suddenly became orange jumpsuit tied around waist and sexy tank top.
Wasn't she wearing that in the first one?
No, it was orange
I used
jumpsuit
to
up
have a
to the neck
friend
in the
for.
first one.
Oh,
Online.
she got a little more. She slipped into something more
Excuse me,
comfortable.
hello?
Yeah, I think it was a hotter
Hello.
day in the Aperture Science facility then. Maybe she just all that jumping around was making her a bit sweaty.
Kids from an
Yeah.
orphanage, not
Don't
all
mind
men
if I
can
just
play
slip
or
this
even be.
off. That's true. That's fun. And Scavenger, thanks for the $10 American, who says whenever
Please
a
get a lot of
dark
these.
woods slash
Main road,
asylum slash
Francis.
whatever horror comes
Francis
out,
and
I wonder
Arthur
what's
doing all right.
essential for horror. Dim
Jack
lighting,
wasn't
poor footing,
amused, but he did
decaying
spec the cover
structures.
fire.
Could you have a horror game as well lit as Get Out?
I'd say so. I'd
My
say
oldest
if you want to
friend.
break it right down,
As a kid, I'd usually.
the essence of horror is atmosphere, and that can come from sound, it can come from visuals, it can even come from a feeling.
Right. The essence of horror is just something wrong, right? Is
Yeah.
the feeling of something wrong
Yeah.
without knowing what it
I mean, if
is?
you've ever seen Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared,
Hmm.
or if you've ever played Bug Snacks, there's certainly an air of horror to those things, even though they are brightly lit and cheerful.
Yes.
I mean, it gets
Yes.
a lot more overt in Don't Hug Me, I'm Scared, but there's still an air of sinisterness early on.
Yes. Yeah, I think you can look at a movie like Get Out. You can look at one of my favorite horror movies, The Witch, aka The Vovitch, which mostly is shot during the day. And yes, it's just about a feeling of something not being correct and not knowing what that is. Atmosphere, atmosphere, atmosphere.
Damn it, I've forgotten where to go in this game. Are we going in the bathroom?
Interesting.
It's you know what? What's interesting is the fixed camera angles, except for the cinematic shots, like when she's going down the hallway and the camera follows her a little bit,
Yeah, that's fun. I think like a slow zoom down a hallway is one of the easiest, horror set pieces.
Yes.
There's just something about it. Right, I'm looking for a tie clip. It's definitely somewhere. Well, is there anywhere I haven't been? Oh, I think this is it.
You did it.
Oh, no, it isn't.
Never mind. Try again.
That was the room we start. This is the room we started in, isn't it?
Right. Speakeasy, I never saw Midsommar. I've heard very good I've heard well no actually I've heard bad things about it is what I will say. I've heard that it is a horror movie that I wouldn't much care for, and a lot of it was spoiled for me. And so I'm not gonna say it. I'm not gonna see it because I've heard I probably would not like it.
All right.
Yeah, the only thing weird about the hallway zoom in, zoom out is when you suddenly change direction and the camera suddenly goes.
That was always the problem with fixed camera games, is that you'd push your controller to go in a certain direction, and then the camera would switch position, and you'd be suddenly be pushing in the wrong direction.
Oh, yeah. What did you think about that, like, regarding first Resident Evil game? I know I always hated those controls in the first Resident Evil game.
Well, that had its own annoyances, of course. I mean, initially it was tank controls where you'd push forward and your character would go forward and you'd press left and right to turn. Mm-hmm. And it was hard to gauge exactly in what direction the character was facing before you pressed forward. Okay, I am...
Clearly... Are you still looking for the tie clip?
Clearly there's something wrong with my head. I'm struggling to remember
how you to get just past played it. This game.
I know. I finished this game.
Oh, so it has left your mind?
Help me out, chat. What do you do?
All right. For anyone who's played this in the chat, Yahtzee needs a tie clip.
Yeah. Where's the tie? It's on the mantle in the living room. Is it?
That's what they're saying.
Okay.
That's, according to Lampy, that's where it is, on the mantle in the living room.
What mantle? It's there. You got to focus on the clock.
Is that what they're saying? Yeah, next to the clock. Wherever the clock is.
Okay, I found it. Aha! Thank you.
Thank you, Lampy.
Okay.
Timmy Kelly, thanks for the $5 American. Who says to both Yahtzee and Jack? Do you think Bloodborne does Lovecraftian horror well? If so, what elements of the game do you think make it effective?
Well, it certainly references all that cosmic horror stuff. And all the stuff about knowledge of the ancients makes people go mad, which is a classic Lovecraftian theme. Sorry, when people say Lovecraftian horror, they mean, like, a lot of things. I mean... The effectiveness of the way people use Lovecraft horror these days is the use in, like, the grotesque and stuff, but the originally Lovecraftian horror was just cosmic horror, which is a sort of horror that doesn't really translate to the modern age.
Right. His big shtick was the undescribable horrors of the unknown, right?
Yeah. And, like, and I feel like these days we know a lot more. Well, Lovecraft was writing at a time when people were just coming to terms with the fact that we're not God's chosen people. We're just a smear of DNA on a rock floating through infinite empty blackness.
And yes.
Our existence is, in the grand scheme of things, basically completely insignificant. I mean, that was mold-breaking for its time because, you know, for the longest time, most people were Christians, and, you know. God had a plan for us. We were his special children.
Right. Now Lovecraft just means squid monsters.
Yeah. The whole point of Lovecraftian horror was we were supposed to be horrified at the mere thought that there might be aliens or something more important than us.
Yes. Taught me to
accept. And there's a lot of Lovecraftian stories where someone just goes, oh, we've discovered that aliens stroke an advanced civilization separate from humanity exists outside of our influence, and then the person who finds that out goes mad.
That being said, the way Bloodborne paces out its monstrosities, I think, is very Lovecraftian, because it starts out as a very simple zombie werewolf game.
Yeah, and then
there's zombies, there's werewolves, there's ogres.
Yeah, and then, like, the scope sort of expands as you go through, I suppose.
Yes.
Until you're dealing with gigantic Lovecraftian monstrosities. Traveling to these weird other dimensions of the inner mind.
Like, the first time you interact with the bagmen, it is terrifying. It is absolutely pants-browning terrifying. And then, yes, then you're dealing with, like, the monsters that were invisible but now aren't, and you can't kill. Oh, it's beautiful. the way it ramps up the creepiness into the, like, and so it plays on that unknown element where you're like, oh, I think I have a handle on the world, I feel like I know what's going on, and then it keeps pulling the rug out from under you. So I dig that if we're going to compare it to Lovecraft. Which, hey, we are.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of ties in well with the From Software model, I suppose. The whole pulling the rug out from under you.
Mm-hmm.
For some reason, the Gaping Dragons brings to mind.
Oh, what a beautiful enemy the Gaping Dragon is. That's just classic setup and payoff, where the little nose pops up and it kind of looks like a face, and you go, oh, it's just going to be a dragon. Oh, wait.
Yeah. It's something else.
Adam Alden, thanks for the $5 American, who says, Yahtzee Jack, or chat, are there any books on Audible with Yahtzee's writing style? I'm itching to hear more, waiting for Differently Morphous 2.
I was going to say, besides all of my books, I suppose.
While they wait for Differently Morphous 2.
Well, my style is heavily influenced by writers like Douglas Adams, Terry Pratchett, and going back a bit, P.G. Woodhouse and Jerome K. Jerome.
Mm-hmm.
So you might want to start with those names. I want to say Jerome K. Jerome was like the original sort of clever, humorous British writer who just had a very clever way of putting things. And his influence can be seen in Woodhouse, whose influence can be seen in Douglas Adams.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's like the start of that particular thread, if you ask me.
Well, there you go. Yeah, and Douglas Adams, you know, his two... am I going to forget what they're called? Oh, no. Dirk Gently. His two Dirk Gently books are up on audiobook. I want to say first Dirk Gently is even read by him.
Hmm.
I don't know if the second one is.
See, that can be good or bad. I mean, it probably works in that case because Douglas Adams was a broadcaster before he was an author.
No, and it's good. Dirk Gently read by Douglas Adams is legitimately a fun listen. There's a... Thinking of Yahtzee's writing / speaking style, Neil Gaiman has a really fun audiobook that I listened to on Audible recently, and I'm trying to remember what it's called, and so I'm going to look it up, who I think has a very similar kind of nonchalant / magical style as you do.
Well, he was part of Terry Pratchett's set. They were good friends.
They were good for... Oh, well, that's good. I want to say, is it called Neverwhere?
Oh, yes. That's pretty good, Neverwhere.
Neverwhere, yeah. Neverwhere is a good book, and I want to say on Audible, it might be read by Neil Gaiman. That's a good one.
I think there's a new Audible adaptation of Neil Gaiman's Sandman as well that came out fairly recently.
Oh, okay.
Though that's less, you know, comedy.
Sure. Jim Malone, Yahtzee would like you to give Talk Fee a scratch, if you could.
Should I do it on camera?
That's what they're. I think they want to see the dog. We got to see the dog.
Talk Fee, you're up.
Oh, there you go.
And I don't believe I've woken him up.
Aww. I know. I quite enjoyed a slight offshoot of the Discworld series, the Tiffany Aching series.
Yes.
Starting with the We Free Men, really fun fantasy book.
Specifically for younger readers, I believe.
Yeah, I think it's a young adult series, but you know, it's a fun read. Or listen, it's a fun listen, I should say, because I listen to them.
All right, just establishing stuff about the main character.
Good.
She has a certain quality about her which may or may not have been given away by the title.
Oh. Oh. Oh.
I think this might be part of why this character sort of fell flat for me, is because, yeah, she's a medium, she can contact the dead. And this is an established quality about her, so nothing really comes as a surprise to her. The way it comes as a surprise to the audience. You just go, ugh, this again.
Okay, no, but this is like, this is what we're seeing here is like the selling point of the game, right? You're controlling two people simultaneously.
Well, yes. Or the same person who exists simultaneously in two worlds.
Oh, okay.
The world of the living and the world of the dead.
Oh. It's fine, Jack. Well, then there you go. Oh, and you know, before we move on from audiobooks, I just got done listening to Gideon the Ninth.
All right.
Which is a fascinating, fascinating book. It's a bit dry in the middle. Thinking of your style, the character of Gideon is someone that I could see you having written. The way in which she interacts with the world is very... Yahtzee-like.
All right,
and it's about necromancers in the future of space.
The future of space, no less.
The future of space, yes. And she is a warrior protecting a necromancer. And necromancy is real. And what I can say is the beginning's great. It's a little dry in the middle, and the ending is ball tighteningly fantastic. A great listen.
I'd look into that. I'm still looking for a book to read.
I quite enjoyed Gideon the Ninth, so wanted to get that recommendation out before we moved on.
So tails off in the middle, is it?
A little bit for me.
Well, as long as you start strong and finish strong. See, that's the problem this game has. sort of the opposite. If anything, it picks up in the middle and. It starts kind of dull and it ends horribly. And it's probably the middle where you'd be most engaged.
Oh.
As anyone who's written a stand-up set knows, you gotta start strong and finish strong.
Oh. Oh, look at that's fun. How she's like hugging no one in the real world.
Yeah.
That's fun. Right, you like it's all about the last thing you leave them with, which is why like if you it's fun if you watch kind of like newer people doing stand up, you can kind of tell what they think their last joke is going to be, and if it doesn't land quite right, it's always embarrassing.
I was reading some advice on how to do stand up once, and they suggested just make a big list of all your jokes, move the funniest one to the end. Move the second funniest one to the start. Move the third funniest one to just before your last one. And just keep staggering them out like that.
Yeah, I think that's correct. And it's like, have a second best funniest one just in case your first funniest one doesn't land.
Well, of course, the difficult part of that advice is knowing which is your funniest joke. Because I'm quite bad at knowing what's going to be the takeaway jokes from all my zero punctuation. I'm forever going to like the quote pages and the TV tropes page to see which specific bits people quote the most.
I used to think everyone saw the world the way I did.
I guess that's why I created the format of speaking very fast and saying a lot of things. Because if I just throw enough things out there that I think are funny, some of them land somehow.
Yeah. No, and you know, like that's kind of like you do where you're checking with what the audience is doing. That's why stand-ups do so many shows, is so they can work on their material. Oh, this joke landed. That was a surprise. I'll move that to the end. This joke landed.
I hear that's gotten tougher in the modern age, because a lot of audiences still have this expectation that every show you're going to do is going to be unique in its own way. So if there's like cell phone footage of you doing the same joke on two different nights,
I'm hanging up.
People say, "Oh, what a lazy boy."
Yeah, I can imagine in the era of cell phones and everybody set being up on YouTube, that would be incredibly difficult.
Thanks to $2, Andrew S., who says, how do you guys feel about Peri Peri Chicken? Ooh, I did like a cheeky Nando's back when I lived in Australia.
Mm.
Not much opportunity for that these days.
Yeah, see, I don't know if I've ever had Peri Peri Chicken.
See, there's a fast food chain called Nando's in Britain and Australia that does Peri Peri Chicken, which is a sort of, I think it's South American. It's like a spicy sauce.
I know what Peri Peri sauce is, or, you know, we have Peri Peri sauce here, which is the best hot sauce. Yes.
Hmm.
So if it's similar to the, is it a hot sauce that has like a citrusy thing to it?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Because that's a fantastic hot sauce.
Yes, Artem Herb. I haven't been living in Australia for some years now. I left in 2016, I think.
Oh, quite a while.
Yeah.
And
still, I lived there for 13 years. Spent my 20s there. It was a big part of my emotional development into an adult.
I believe that. Scavenger, thanks for the $10 American, who says, everyone raves about H.P. Lovecraft. Are you fans of Rod Serling and his work? I like how we were still insignificant, but we should still support each other. Plus, he wrote the Planet of the Apes twist.
I didn't know that. All I know about Rod Serling is that he used to present the Twilight Zone.
And he wrote it, I believe. I believe he wrote a bunch of Twilight Zone.
Well, that explains why he was presenting it, I suppose.
Yeah. I believe he was like the creative lead on Twilight Zone, though I'm going to say that and everyone's going to say I'm wrong.
Huh. Don't really see that much these days, do you? The showrunner being the central talent as well.
Yeah, I guess you don't really see that too much. Though you are seeing kind of a new wave of the showrunner being as famous as, say, a director would be.
Right, like the two dudes who did Game of Thrones.
Right.
If not for the best reasons.
Or like, you know, what era of Doctor Who are you talking about? Who was the showrunner?
Yeah.
Or,
Douglas Adams was showrunner for a brief time, you know?
Oh, was he?
Yeah.
Wasn't that where Dirk Gently originally came from? It was a rejected...
I think that might be the case, yes.
It was a rejected Doctor Who script. On nothing but a hunch. I believe that's right. But yeah, no, Twilight Zone's fantastic. I could rewatch episodes of Twilight Zone all the time. Beautiful show. I haven't seen the new one, and I also haven't heard anything, which must mean that it's not very good. There's a new Twilight Zone being produced by Jordan Peele. And I have not heard anything about it, which I believe means it's bad.
Hmm. Yeah, I mean, these days, yeah, I mean, it's generally safe to assume that anything that's on the streaming service is just a sort of another part of the bland swill.
Mm.
And you only really hear about it if it's particular standout good.
Yes. According to Scavenger, Rod Serling wrote 94 of the 150 episodes of Twilight Zone.
Ooh.
Over half, a significant amount.
See, I feel like that's an American thing. I feel like in a lot of British TV, it's accepted that there'll just be one writer the whole way through.
But really?
But then British TV tends to be in shorter seasons, of course.
Yes. Right off the bat. Yeah, a British television season is sometimes, up to 8 episodes? So.
In fact, I think in British TV, the way it's done... I don't know if it's still the case, but the writer kind of was the showrunner.
Oh, okay.
Front gate was locked up tight. Where in like American TV, the director was.
Right. Right, right. Anyone yeah, know? No, and you know, American TV, usually, obviously things have changed now since Netflix has taken over, but usually an American TV show is like 24 episodes a year.
Yeah,
so you can't have one writer.
Yeah, that seems like too much.
In hindsight, yes. In hindsight, it's just too much.
I feel like if when you have less episodes, you can concentrate the jokes better.
Yeah.
In a comedy show, at least.
Or if it's a drama, you can concentrate the pacing better. Yeah. I guess it kind of depends on what it is you're looking to accomplish. Let's see here. Parkeed Tixt says, "Hey Yahtzee, in your Fallout 76 review, you said you think that we'll see another period like in the early 2000s again for games. Do you still stand by that? And do you think it's close? Would be nice with some quality games."
Sorry, I didn't quite follow the passing of that sentence.
You said you think we'll see another period like the early 2000s again for games.
We're going to have to do better than that.
I'm assuming that means that you said the early 2000s were a good time for games, and do you think we'll get there again? That's what I'm reading there. I don't know if I quite got that right, Parky Text.
I guess I might have said that. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to think. Yeah, I mean, it sounds about right. And that would have been around the PlayStation 2 era, which is probably still one of the best times, at least for creativity in mainstream gaming. But that was before there was like such a large separation between AAA and everything else.
Yeah, I mean, we're living in such an amazing age right now with incredible access to incredibly indie games. It's just finding them is the problem.
So this is where the game starts getting Silent Hilly.
Ooh, okay. Yeah, you're in the woods. Buddha Bell, thanks for the $10 American. Just got here. Is this the ending to Metal Gear Solid 2?
No.
You found a ball. You found a ball.
It's a spooky ball.
So spooky.
No, I think this game isn't set in the present day, but it says, I want to say it's set in the 90s.
Okay.
From what I remember of like some of the random documents and audio logs.
90s is... That's pretty, like... I think a lot of people are going there to so their characters won't have cell phones.
They certainly are a tension ruiner, aren't they?
Yes. And so it's like, okay, what's like the most modern we can be without cell phones?
I mean, it's a one-line fix. You just have a character look at their cell phone and go, huh, no signal.
Right. Or, like, they're getting out of their car and it's a close-up shot where their cell phone falls out of their pocket and they don't, you know, by the time they look for it, they don't have it. So, yeah, 90s Poland is where this takes place.
There you go.
And Peter Simon, welcome to bonus content over on YouTube. We appreciate that support. Or it breaks on the ground. Yeah, you just got to get rid of the cell phones. I kind of liked how they handled it in the remake of The Evil Dead, which wasn't specifically set in any time period. It could have been the 2000s, it could have been the 90s, it could have been the 80s. They just never brought it up. Like,
well, they had the luxury of not having to bring it up, I suppose.
Yeah,
because it was just an enclosed space horror film.
Yes,
and no one really cares what sort of time period that was in. It doesn't really change anything significant.
Yes,
I mean, they could have done that in like the 19th century.
In all but the costume, basically, yeah. Stratos Maktra, thank you for the $5 Canadian, who says, Jack and or Yahtzee, did you see the Dirk Gently Netflix show? And if so, what were your thoughts on it?
Actually, I did. The one with Elijah Wood, right?
Yeah, I don't think it was Netflix, though. I think it was sci-fi? Might have been a sci-fi original.
I remember I watched it with Kes. I remember we kind of liked it. Didn't feel very much like Dirt Gently, of course. Something
happened here. Yes. That's the big problem, is it definitely was not Dirk Gently. Yeah. The first season was, in my mind, okay. Like, it was fine. It was fine. The second season, the entire bottom fell out, and it was pretty garbage. The split would come, but it didn't get if a place had a it didn't get the tell, Dirk Gently no. vibe right. The thing that's so amazing about it, at very least the first Dirk Gently book, is it's Ghostbusters, is he's kind of a scam artist.
Yeah.
You know, he's a detective, sure, but really he's just a schmo who understands how the supernatural works and uses it to grift people out of money, and it's kind of great.
So just getting back to the game for a second. Apparently, the Dark World is designed by some famous Polish artist whose name escapes me.
Oh, okay.
And that's kind of what made me think of Darkseid, which I mentioned in my review, because that was an adventure game with art by H.R. Giger.
Oh,
where they had him design like an evil Dark World that was the equivalent of the real world. And this is where we introduce an open quotes gameplay mechanic.
Yes.
Which I thought was going to turn into a combat mechanic. But, well, I guess we'll get to it. But
so, yeah, you're...
You charge up yourself with spirit power.
What?
Let's see. Where's the bloody run button? There it is.
I see you are existing in simultaneously in the real world and in the spirit world.
Yes.
And everything you do in one, you do the exact same thing in the other.
Yeah. If you're blocked in one, even if you're not blocked in the other, you're blocked in both.
Oh, okay.
So you have to get past obstacles with cunning and inventory puzzles.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some spirit energy here. Now our arm, which is covered in what look like tree mushrooms, has gone all white and glowy on us.
Okay. And what do you do with your mushroom arm?
Well, I will show you when we get to the place where you use it.
But everything moves so
everything moves so bloody slowly here.
I've noticed that. Oh, look at your little jog.
Reminds me of the running in the Fatal Frame games,
right? Mm-hmm.
Internationally known as Project Zero, because the way you're playing like an inept schoolgirl who can just about hold up a camera with no fighting ability, and you run like you don't particularly care about running somewhere.
Right.
You're just trying to make it look like you're running.
Yeah. Like when you're in a crosswalk and a car stops for you and you want to make it look like you're walking faster.
Look, I'm hurrying out of your way, see? I understand that you are important.
Okay.
So when you've got your arm full of spirit energy,
yeah,
you can unleash a spirit blast.
Kamehameha!
Good for you, Marion.
Ooh, okay.
In this case, that's like reactivated the power. And at this point, I thought, okay, this is probably going to turn into some kind of combat mechanic.
Mm-hmm.
Like, evil ghosts come and get at you, and you got to spirit blast their asses away.
Yeah.
That doesn't really happen.
Oh, okay.
And I feel like this game could have benefited from a combat mechanic. It makes me wonder if the plan was at some point to have a combat mechanic.
Sure, and maybe they worried that took away from the serious, creepy tone.
Yeah.
Because
It feels like this mechanic, as it's used, is more like, you know, use key and door. The usual inventory stuff.
That's literally what you just did, you needed the Kamehameha key.
Yeah. That's generally how it's used. You're either restarting fuse boxes, or you're blowing an obstacle out of the way.
No.
And there's a couple of bits where you're being chased by a monster, and I think if you use the Spirit Blast, you can, like, fend them off one time so they don't insta-kill you.
Uh-huh.
But most of the time, you just get insta-killed by them. That's not really using it as a combat system, though.
All right, so that was the introduction to the two-world puzzle system.
Yes.
Underwhelming so far. Stephen Brown, thanks for the $5 American. Did either of you play the Tony Hawk game, the old ones or the recent remake?
I believe you did.
I fucking love Tony Hawk. I love all of them, every single one of them. And yes, I played the remake and loved it. It's a very faithful remake. It looks gorgeous, and it is the same arcadey.
Excuse me.
The combos, skateboard around, listening to punk and ska and 90s hip-hop. It's beautiful. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, never really my thing.
Ah.
I think this is the first point where I thought, oh, this is probably Silent Hill inspired.
Okay.
It was just this big, walking across this big foggy parking lot. Took me a while to notice, like, Akira Yamaoka was doing the soundtrack. Because you can usually tell. You got a very distinctive sound. And, yeah, it was when I was hearing this music that's starting up now. I thought, this sounds like Akira Yamaoka.
And then did you look it up?
I did, and it turned out, yes, it was Akira Yamaoka.
Ah. Well, then, good. First of all, good for you. You figured it out.
I mean, this bit in particular, very reminiscent for me of the start of Silent Hill 2. Mm-hmm. When James is, like, quite a long way from the camera and you move him around a car park.
Oh, yeah, look at that.
Yeah.
Look at you going far away from the camera.
The fixed camera works in this sort of thing is that it sort of gives you the sense of being watched, way that a standard chase camera doesn't.
Sure,
makes you feel like the way they put like random foreground objects between you and your character makes you think, ooh, we're some kind of creature of the forest peering at them from around a tree.
We're the unknown entity voyeuristically peering in on them. Yeah, I can get that, and as long as it doesn't f up your movement too much, I suppose it's not the worst thing in the world. It's all about feel, right?
Now, I wouldn't call this a second person camera, Artem Hub. You know what was a second person camera? It was the mechanic in the Forbidden Siren games, where you had the ability to jack into the minds of the enemies and look at yourself through their eyes.
Now, what's a fine machine like you doing in a place
like this? DragonFan209, thanks for the $4.99 American, who says, both of these people live in their own mad world. But whose world would you say is bigger, Hideo Kojima or Peter Molyneux?
I guess Hideo Kojima's world is the bigger one.
Mm-hmm.
And just Death Stranding alone, looking massive.
That's true.
Look at all that empty space. I feel like Peter Molyneux's Fable games in particular always felt like, even when they're like, they seem physically big, they seem to be enclosed within a rather limited range of views.
Yes.
And then, if you see what I mean.
And what's he doing now? Is he making games anymore?
I don't know.
Is he making the new Fable one?
What is Peter Molyneux doing?
Right.
Well, whatever he's doing, he's probably exaggerating it.
Ha, hey-o! Besmarch, thanks for the $2 American. This is definitely in the running for the Bland 5. Calling it already, we're only in February. Wow.
Possibly.
You made the right call sending me.
Yeah.
I tend to feel the same way about a lot of Blooper Team's games.
Because
They started doing walking simulators, and I always feel like they've never quite gotten away from that mindset. There's a lot of linearly moving along from one set piece to the next, and you're just supposed to go, wow, look at the exciting visual someone created.
That's so much of games, though, and that's so much of horror games in general.
Blooper Team in particular, though, I get a lot of the walking simulator mindset where you just, all you do is push forward and it takes you down, like, it's like exploring the Haunted Mansion at Disneyland, I suppose. Just being herded along a path.
I guess. I think, you know, you and I talked about this maybe I don't know if that episode has come out yet, but about like how this could very possibly work in a VR sense.
Yes. When did we talk about that?
I don't know if that episode came out yet, so yeah. Heads up.
In a slightly civil war, we were talking about how you feel VR would make sense, and we mentioned adventure games.
Yes.
Specifically like escape room style adventure games, where you have to explore the nooks and crannies and try things in locks and stuff.
Exactly, and so this is a situation probably again where, like, if you are actually like physically exploring this room
in VR, everything is touchable, it could add to that creepy atmosphere. Because then you would, you know, be in a more enclosed space. Grant Johnson, welcome to Tip Jar. I'm not sure what that is over on YouTube, but welcome anyway. We appreciate your support. And Ask Steve Who, thanks for the $5 American, who says, Jack, have you stuck with Slay the Spire? I keep ending up going back to it, as a few other deck builders are as tight up to Ascension 5 on all characters. I've unlocked everything. I've unlocked everything in Slay the Spire, and I've beaten the final boss a couple times now. I've beat the final boss with three of the four characters, and I've unlocked everything, so I don't feel like I need to play it anymore.
Fair enough.
But Slay the Spire is fantastic. Really enjoyed it. Obviously, I played it a ton on a bunch of different systems. It's still a great game. I just did it all. But, whoa, what was that? You blew some dust off that shoe.
This is one of the sort of random audio log mechanics. Sometimes if you can use your spirit powers to detect echoes coming off objects.
Mm-hmm.
In that case, it was just people having a bit of a scream. Probably something was happening to them had not been happening to them.
Something really spooky was going on here. You can't see it, but it was pretty spooky.
Oh yeah.
Hello?
Spooky. Anyone? As fuck.
Thomas? It's just,
that's what this game is. But yeah, I'm still, as far as like deck builders like Slay the Spire, I'm still like pretty closely following the development of For the Warp, which is a deck builder but set in an FTL-like space battle. That is pretty darn good. Still in pretty early access, but that's what I've been playing to fill that void.
Now, this is a very Silent Hill 2-y moment.
All right, I'm ready.
There's a thing through some bars, which, looking at them, she could probably squeeze through if she put her mind to it.
She does seem quite slender.
If you can get your head through, you can probably get the rest.
Yeah, that's really true. I guess that's Thomas? Depending a lot on your midsection. Mm. Looking at myself here. Oh, just got to lay off the carbs for a minute. Then I'll be able to fit through.
Marianne. It's just a good old-fashioned haunted hotel. Calm your ass down.
Yeah, her name was Marianne.
Oh. Good.
I wasn't sure. When I wrote that.
Oh. Well, good. You did it.
I don't know why this game didn't, like, draw me in the way Silent Hill did. I mean, in Silent Hill 2, there's, like, a long walk through the fog to the town before anything happens.
Mm-hmm.
And by the end of it, you just feel really immersed in a way that I don't get from this game. And I'm trying to put my finger on why.
Do you think that has anything to do with your current position?
How do you mean?
Well, when Silent Hill 2 came out, were you a professional game reviewer?
Admittedly, no.
And so, ooh, look at that creepy girl. So, is it possible that now that you've played so many games, that it's, even though it's pretty similar, it doesn't have the same weight?
That could well be it, but I want to say I don't feel the connection to the protagonist I had with Silent Hill 2.
Oh, okay.
I feel like, I mean, James, I guess because he was more of an everyman, you felt more, I felt more sympathetic.
Ooh, sure.
Like I feel like I could project myself more into that setting. And in this case, this is a character who's got like magic powers that I don't understand. And
gotcha.
Got a clear sort of history of, that that's driving their actions.
Sure. So it's harder to slip into the character because she has psychic powers. That's possible. That's possible.
Well, I wanna that feels like a lazy argument. It might be just like some subtle differences in like camera positioning and audio that means it doesn't quite have this an atmosphere as absorbing.
That's I think there's a lot of possibilities here.
Or it could be having long cut scenes. That could be a thing.
Just popping that in here. Popping that in here. Ooh, look at her arm. That's fun. It's mostly not there.
I don't think it's
That's
there at
neat.
all.
Well, I was talking about the other one with like the holes in it. That's neat. That's creepy and neat. I like that. That's good imagery.
But Insis asks, has there ever been a game with a long-haired male protagonist? The Darkness? That's
I
where's
was
one.
wondering, have you seen
If you go back a bit, the sort of 80s action hero times,
Oh, yeah.
you could probably find a few. What's that game that's... You're a dude with a shotgun in a fantasy world, and it's a sort of side-on step platformer. Blackthorn? Is that what it was called?
Oh, I have no idea.
He had long hair. The main
What?
character of Prey had long hair, I think.
Yeah,
Gordon Freeman had a little ratty ponytail in the first Half-Life.
I think a lot of male characters have long hair. What about that the Jack Black rock and roll RTS game?
Brutal Legend.
Brutal Legend, right?
That was
There's some long hair for you.
more of a mullet thinking about it.
I can't go that way.
Oh yeah,
Yeah.
Alucard from Castlevania. Yeah, there's loads of
Ooh.
characters with male characters long hair. Probably a lot in Japanese games, if
Ooh,
you thought
yeah.
about it.
Absolutely.
Hatred. Thank you, GH Ninja Zero. Old Jeffrey Cuddle Trousers.
Javier Olmedo, thank you for joining us in Early Access over on YouTube. We appreciate that support. And Kev Croft, thanks for the £5, who says, "Evening, chaps from the UK. Hope you're both well. Can I just say that I enjoyed the stealth, slightly Civil War. 47 got my vote on that one."
Yeah, I think that one turned out well. We went on what I thought was quite an amusing riff on what would it be like if Big Boss actively tried to employ guards in the bases he was trying to infiltrate.
Yeah, there's some fun ideas in that one. I agree. There were some fun ideas in that one. Yeah, that was a good one, and really, I just enjoyed the excuse to finally play the newer Hitman
Yeah,
games.
you hadn't.
Because I hadn't yet, and yeah,
Oh,
they're
yeah.
really fun and interesting.
I wanted to use the topic because Hitman 3 had just come out. And what better excuse to have a go on Hitman?
Yeah, that was a good one. I agree. Zombie Elvis, thanks for the £10. What's your opinion on real world spirit mediums?
You mean bullshit artists?
Heyo! I think you're talking about grifters.
Yes.
Yes.
Parasites, and I hope they all die.
I don't know if I want to go that far, but yeah, I mean, they're scamming people. They're scamming people for money.
All right, time for another gameplay mechanic for solving puzzles with.
Okay.
Sometimes, if we're blocked in one world but not in another, we can switch exclusively to the spirit world in what's termed an out-of-body experience.
Fuse box.
But
Energy
if we
discovered.
stay in this state for too long, then we gradually lose ourselves and fade away.
Oh.
An out-of-body experience. It's like
Okay.
taking a plunge into
Great.
nothingness. Stay
It's
under it.
good. Great. But you can only do this sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just
Only when the game needs you to do it.
well, I think you can do it like pretty much any time, but there's only really a reason to do it if there's a
Oh,
specific puzzle that requires it.
Okay, Marianne. Now get your ghostly ass back and power up that elevator.
There it. I need to I'll be right back. There is a loud thumping noise happening somewhere in the house, and I would like to find out what that is. I will be back in just a moment.
Maybe it's one of the sandworms from Dune. I've got to wonder about the mechanics of this whole situation. I mean, if does damage in the real world just automatically happen in the spirit world, and it occasionally does and doesn't happen, because why? Because of spirits? Oh, come on, you can jump across that. Are you back, Jack?
I'm back now.
What was it?
Children.
Well,
if you can believe that.
The standard explanation.
Right. Right. Okay, you're back in your body, but in the dual worlds.
Yes, we successfully got out of the lift.
Hooray! Jack seems to be running at 5 frames per second.
Yeah, you're getting a little choppy there.
As long as they can hear me.
Yeah, your voice seems fine.
Yeah, do you really need to see me? I'll just try to stay as still as humanly possible. And then, you know, then it's like I'm here. I'll cover my mouth with my microphone, and then I'll just be very, very still. Boom. Jack teleported, called it. Yeah, I mean, yeah, I have 2 kids. There's noises. That's how it works.
I mean, if you got 2 kids, you'd be more concerned if there wasn't any noise.
No, mine are old enough now where, you know, they take care of themselves.
I think I'm at that stage of my daughter's development where she's at the stage where she just started like being able to like get distracted by toys and books and things. But I'm still at the point where if she's quiet for a long time, my brain goes, what's she done? Why aren't I hearing her? What has she killed herself with?
Yes, you're so used to the constant noise that something must be wrong if it's not there.
The constant noise and the constant need for attention. After a while, they start being able to amuse themselves.
Ooh, that's when it starts to get good.
Yeah, we're actually both sleeping through the night now.
Hey, congratulations.
Well, I say both. All 3 of us are.
Cheerful Spider, thanks for the 213 American, who says, welcome back, secret monster wearing Jack's skin. And now Cookie wants to come in.
Oh, yeah, Toffee now as well. Toffee also sleeps through the night.
Hey, all of you are there. I'll let you in.
Oh, shit.
Come on in.
I didn't even know I could do that.
But you know what the cost is.
It's Cookie.
Come here, Cooks. Come here. If you come in, you gotta show everybody your face and get internet points.
Toffee, look, it's Cookie. Say hello.
There's Toffee. Look, you see Toffee? Oh, hi, yes, I love you. Look,
hi,
Toffee.
Hi, Cookie. Hi, Cookie. Together they could be a toffee cookie.
Ooh, I would eat that. All right. Dog cams are a go.
Okay.
that's her job. If she insists on coming in, she has to go on camera and earn her money.
That is a good rule. Never get enough dogs. Oh, I just got an achievement for some reason.
Oh.
An achievement that I didn't get during my previous playthrough. Not sure why. It was an achievement
called... What did
you do? I don't know. It was an achievement called Spirit Walking. I'm assuming it's something along the lines of spent X amount of time in an out-of-body experience.
Sure. Tommy Salty, thanks for the 10 Polish notes. Dads and Dogs, new escapist show coming soon. Yes, it would be a very boring show where Yahtzee and I would talk about, grilling and marinating.
I don't grill much.
Although oh, you don't grill much.
I have opinions on how to cook steak.
Don't we all?
Just make sure your skillet is really hot and make sure your steak is nice and dry before you put it on, or you won't get a good enough sear.
Absolutely, but I guess, yeah, my question is then why not do it on the grill?
I haven't got a grill.
Oh, you should get a grill. Get the grill really hot and do the same thing, because then, and especially if you use the right charcoal, then you get a nice smoky flavor along with the meat.
I guess we haven't done much outdoor cooking.
Well, obviously not in this weather.
Although, you know, California, it can be January and a nice sunny day as well.
That is true. The stream has gone to the dogs. Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, grill marks are great. P. Mestri Polito. Obviously, that's just an aesthetic thing.
If you want to make your own Burger King whoppers.
Exactly. But, you know, like a pan. I'm not dissing pan searing a steak. I think that's great, too. Whoa,
I like to pan sear and then finish in the oven if it's like a thick pork chop or something.
Ooh, yeah. Just give me some time. That's good. I do have a sous vide that I break out occasionally.
I don't know why, but it gives me shivers.
Which is the best way to make steaks. Stick it in the sous vide, get it to the perfect temperature, let it finish cooking there, then finish it either on the grill or on the skillet.
I bought my wife a nice crock pot the other day.
Ooh.
She made a nice lamb Marrakesh the other day.
That sounds wonderful.
Nice slow-cooked lamb. Just the fork goes right through. Speaking of meats, the dark world. That looks like it's made of ham.
Right? Memories of grief. It does look like it's made of ham a bit. Icy Fire, is the starter set D&D worth it for beginners? Yes? It all depends. Like, really, you know, if you're all beginners, one of you kind of needs to know what you're doing, is the thing with Dungeons & Dragons. And you can find all the resources you need for free on the internet. The kind of the problem is knowing where to look. But you'll figure. Ooh, that's neat. Sorry, I'm looking at like the web people now.
It's another audio log, really.
Oh. that looks really exciting and engaging, but you're just passively watching. Oh, yeah. Of course. Classic.
It's an audio log, but with a tuned to the right frequency puzzle. I feel like I've played a lot of games with those. Where you have to point the analog stick in the right direction. And the closer you are to the right direction, the louder the noise gets. Or whatever.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I think Batman Arkham does that a bit. A fair bit. It's, I think a few games use it as like a lock-picking puzzle.
Oh, that's neat. In any case, starter set's good. It's a nice, simple adventure, from what I know. But if it's something you're thinking you're going to get into, start off with all the free stuff that you can and try to run just as simple and as short a game as you can with all using free stuff. And then you'll know for sure whether it's something you want to invest money into, because you can invest a lot of money into Dungeons & Dragons.
Even more so if you're into something like tabletop wargaming.
Oh, right.
Warhammer 40K or whatever.
All the figurines.
Yeah.
And
terrain.
Oh, God. No, and, you know, I love all of my books, like all of my D&D books. They're fantastic and they're really interesting, but, you know, they ain't cheap.
Jump scare.
Oh, look at that. Wait a minute, your spirit moved, but your human body didn't.
Because I'm in an out-of-body experience.
Oh, okay.
I had to do so to get past a barrier in the real world.
Oh, so they did that on purpose so your real body wouldn't fall. Oh.
Just pulling the plug out of this spirit bathtub.
Draining the blood. Very creepy.
And collecting the razor, which is a... which is another key for another lock. This is a recurring one, because you keep the razor blade for the whole game, and there's quite a few of these, like, skin doors.
Oh, ew.
And each time you have to go through the rigmarole of holding down on the controller. Otherwise it won't pull the razor blade through the skin door.
I'm going to give this points for creepy imagery. I dig that.
Well, speaking as a Silent Hill veteran, feels a little bit cheap. It's a little bit easy. Feels like we could have put a bit more thought into it than just, it's human skin!
Sure. Oh, wait, the skin doesn't even stay there. It just magically disappears once you cut it. Come on, leave the flappy, bloody skin.
It's magic spiritual skin.
F that. I want real creepy skin.
Well, look in the mirror.
Oh, no, that's a quality burn. Quality burn right there. Yeah, no, I don't know. I thought that was creepy. I'll take it. Obviously, I'm not playing the game. I'm just watching it, so I have a very different experience.
So this is where I sort of disengage from a game if it's just pushing forward to continue the whole time.
Oh, right.
And I barely had to... I mean, usually, sometimes, as we did earlier in the stream, things get held up because I'm not really focusing on the game.
Mm.
But I don't really need to at this point.
Yeah, that's true. That's really true.
I mean, this isn't a walking simulator, but because Bluebird Team were walking simulator designers, their games are still designed in a way to herd you in a very specific way.
Mm.
So you always find the puzzle solution at exactly the right time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. 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 From from a visual perspective, I like how this looks, and I can understand completely why it would be incredibly boring to play.
Right.
Is all I can say, but I do like, you know, like that, like the web people, you know, the conversation. That's fun. Ah, that's creepy. That's great. But if I was playing this. And this speaks to why, you know, cutscenes and things bother me. It's like I'm expecting a different experience. I'm expecting some sort of interaction.
Mm. Some kind of gameplay mechanic.
What? That would be a way to interact with the game. Yeah. Yeah. You're absolutely right. Absolutely.
Choice and consequence. That's what you need. We need to be asked, should I risk X in order to gain Y?
Ooh, yeah. And is there any risk in this game?
No.
Besides wasting your own time.
The risk is you might have to repeat running away from the monster set piece because the monster caught you.
Ah.
And it's something like Half-Life, one might risk health to acquire more ammo in order to have more survivability later.
Mm-hmm.
That's like a fundament of challenge design. The risk reward.
Yes, yeah, I'm with you. Let's see here. Why do you think ruins are such an amazing and interesting aesthetic? The only thing I think. Wait, what? Like, the only thing I like more than building a cool little town is building a ruined little town.
Well, it ties into some fundamental aspects of the human condition, doesn't it? Entropy, the constant march of time and the evidence of that time having passed. What happened in this town? It immediately adds intrigue. What happened to this town? Why is it... What joys and miseries occurred in its past?
it immediately adds a backstory.
Yes,
it adds a character.
History.
Yes.
That's why it's more interesting.
I couldn't agree more. That's what it needs. It needs a past. It needs to have existed before the player got there. Soulsborne. Yes, I have seen Annihilation. It's pretty good.
Is that that film with Natalie Portman?
It is.
Yeah, I've seen that. I've seen a film with Natalie Portman. I assume it's the same one.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the newer one with Natalie Portman. She goes into like the magical fog place, and there is a million monsters as metaphor.
Now you mention it, I guess I get why watching this game might remind you of it.
Mm-hmm.
I do get occasionally similar vibe.
Yeah. Yeah, and I thought it was all right. I think as I have said in the past, I'm a big fan of monster as metaphor. I feel like they went a little too literal with the monster as metaphor, but it's good for them. All the points.
Pretty on the nose.
Very on the nose. And that's fine. Like, that's where they went with it. That's fine. A lot of neat visuals. And yes, I'm talking about the Natalie Portman movie Annihilation.
I'm following my controller. The triggers keep sticking.
Oh. What are you playing this on?
On the Steam with an Xbox One controller.
Oh, okay.
But at the start, the game says use headphones and a controller. That's the recommended style of play.
Like, you already know, I already know I'm not going to like a game if the game says, like, this is you, if you're not wearing headphones in a dark room, alone, wearing a scarf, make sure your feet are properly elevated before you play this game, you're just not going to have a good time. Then I know I will not like it.
Well, headphones in a dark room does add a certain soupçon to some game experiences, I suppose.
Sure. Well, I guess what I'm saying is if it's so necessary to the game that you do something outside of the game in order for it to get to work.
I don't know, Jack. If you're playing an atmospheric game with a TV on half volume and with like the Archers on the radio next to you and you don't feel immersed, I think that's on you.
Yeah, I guess I just don't like these kind of games, so I'm just pissing on them. So.
That's what we're here for.
That's fair.
I know you probably can't hear it, but Toffee is snoring and it's adorable.
Outdated documents? Wait, it was a metaphor? Yes, it's all a metaphor. Annihilation is a big old metaphor. If I remember correctly, and it's been a while since I've seen the movie, I believe it's just a metaphor for their relationship. Which I think they explicitly say at the end when they get out of the bad place and realize like the real people that they are. It's so heavy-handed.
Sadness.
But it's fine. Stop meeting like this. Very fine.
I told you to follow me.
Take it easy.
This place is huge. It's easy to get lost.
Does Jack know what the Archers is? I know what the Archies are.
Yeah, I just referenced the Archers, which I would be surprised if you knew. It's a very long-running British radio soap opera.
Oh, and you know, when you said that, I thought you said the Archies, which is an old-school American rock band that sang the song Sugar, do-do-do-do-do-do.
Oh, right.
Honey, honey.
Which is also something you might listen to on a radio. So I guess neither works.
And so I was like, oh, yes, if I'm listening to happy, sappy pop music while playing this, like, that's how I took it. So, no, I don't know what the Archers is.
Well, I think you got the gist of my meaning either way.
I'm with you.
Very recently, I think.
The protagonist can veer into the realm of the dead. Yes,
yes.
You are a medium.
Well, it's not so much into the world of the dead as constantly in the world of the dead, but we simultaneously in the world of the living as well.
Yes, and that's why you'll notice that she does the same thing in both worlds, which is neat. That's a neat concept. I dig it.
Yeah. Could have done more with it, but there it is.
Yeah, I mean, like, I like this concept as, like, again, as a visual thing. I really like it. If I'm watching this movie, I really like it. Playing this,
well,
probably not gonna like
it. It's really just a visual, because in gameplay terms, it's really just explore environment, find key for lock, except there's two of the environments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's really just an adventure game with twice as many rooms.
Right, and you know, it was it had a great talking point about, you know, simultaneously rendering two different atmospheres, really showcasing the power of the Xbox. That's the one thing I remember about this game, is like the bullshit talking points. Don't you understand the power?
Yeah, look at the power of the Xbox. Mm-hmm. Here on display on my PC. Duffy snoring's getting louder.
Oh, I think I heard it actually. Which a good example of a game that requires specific outside influence to be good is Dark Souls, with a controller great without nearly unplayable, quote unquote, without mods. Yeah, I think Dark Souls is playable by itself. I think with the addition of the community surrounding Dark Souls, it is significantly easier to play.
Yeah, and there's a lot of stuff you probably won't get by yourself.
Right.
Like how the humanity stuff works.
Or the leveling up, or where you should go, or proper weapon stats, or a million things. Yes.
Yeah.
Oh my god, I heard that. Toffee.
I'm just going to move my mic down to Toffee for a second.
But yeah, you know, I can see that argument.
You won't do it really loudly until I take the mic away. What am I looking for?
I don't know.
A key for a clock. Man, that's Silent Hill 2 comparisons coming thick and fast. That was one of the early puzzles in Silent Hill 2. You had to find a key for a clock.
Someone's been using it.
A key for a clock. Let's see here. Jack and Yachts, are there games that you enjoy and would recommend, but that you think wouldn't make for a good live stream, or at least wouldn't make for a good blind playthrough stream?
I think there's a lot heavily story-based games that don't make good streams.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if there's no live voice acting, it's like a visual novel or something.
Yeah.
I guess this is kind of fun. You change the time in the real world, and it changes what's in the room in the spirit world.
Yeah, that's neat. That's neat, and it looks great. Super creepy. Dig it.
It's rare.
I dig it. Yeah, I think there's a lot of games that fit that criteria where, especially like if it's your first time playing. For me, I know, but the first time I play a game, I really need to pay attention to how to play it, or else I don't know what I'm doing.
Yeah, it's very easy to get distracted.
Yep.
By a chat and things.
Any game that has any sort of like farming component, not like a Stardew Valley, but like a game where you have to backtrack and, you know, do the same thing over and over again,
right,
to get something.
Well, speedrunner streams are really popular, and that's all they do. Play the same game over and over again.
Yeah, but they have a goal. Like, I'm thinking of, I'm going through Dark Souls 3 over on our Thursday stream, and I really wanted one specific sword, which was dropped early by like two specific guys, and so I kept reloading, or you know, going to the bonfire, killing the two guys, it wouldn't drop, going to the bonfire, killing two guys, it wouldn't drop, going to the bonfire, killing two guys, it wouldn't drop. So, and that admittedly is really boring to watch.
Only as boring as you make it, I suppose. You could take the opportunity to tell your chat an interesting story from your life.
Ooh, that's very true. That's very true. I don't know if Yahtzee and I are necessarily experts in this field. Looks like I'm in. So, Jack, we remember your Titanfall 2 pre-reg stream. Hard to watch. What are you talking about? I really enjoy playing Titanfall 2.
It's a good game.
It's a really good game. If you didn't like it, I'm sorry, but I really enjoyed playing it. And I thought that was a pretty fun stream. But, I don't know. The Baldur's side sword? No, the Lothric Knight sword is what I got, which is dropped early in front of where the dancer is by those two Lothric Knights with swords. But it's a very rare drop rate. It's a low drop rate for them, so it took me about 45 minutes of farming in order to get the sword that I wanted. But when I finally got it, I actually got two of them in the same farming run. So there you go, odds.
Nice. Well, gambler's fantasy.
DragonFan209, thanks for the $1.99 American. Do you like peanut butter or hazelnut spread more?
I guess I like hazelnut spread more, but I eat peanut butter more often.
Oh, sure.
Because hazelnut spread, it's just eating chocolate.
Yes.
Can't really justify it nutritionally.
No, it's just chocolate, which is why it's delicious. But for me, peanut butter.
If you're watching a TV ad, and the ad is trying to establish that their food has nutritional benefit because it gives people energy. Probably safe to assume it's just got fuck tons of sugar in it.
Right. Right. I eat so much peanut butter. Every day. I love peanut butter. It's one of my favorite foods. I add peanut butter to other things. Peanut butter.
I quite like peanut butter and apple slices.
Yes, that's a great combination. What I've discovered recently that I usually have as a snack or sometimes as part of a lunch is like vanilla yogurt with fruit on bottom. Take a big old scoop of peanut butter and put it on top, so you have peanut butter, vanilla yogurt, and like a strawberry fruit on bottom, and it's like a peanut butter jelly and cream situation.
Ooh.
And holy gosh darn, it is the bee's freaking knees.
What did I just do?
That's a great question.
I think I reactivated the power. There we go. Let's get the rest of me in there.
Jack, tell Yats that I wouldn't have bought Hades if it hadn't been for his ZP, and it turned into my favorite game of the year. I don't normally do roguelikes, but he tilted the scales on that one.
Supergiant Games, usually a strong contender. Especially in terms of video game storytelling.
And you know, I still haven't played that one.
Hades.
I would probably enjoy it. There's no specific reason why I haven't played it. I just haven't gotten around to it. So, I'm sure I would enjoy it though.
Probably. Have you played Supergiant's previous games?
Oh, what have they made?
They made Pyre, they made Bastion.
I haven't played any of them.
Transistor.
Okay, then that's a big old goose egg. I have not played any of their games.
Which one would I recommend? Well, I guess I'd recommend Hades of them all.
Sure.
For a first timer.
Well, you know, it's like a slashy roguelike, right? Like a hacky slashy roguelike?
Yeah. Yeah. It's easy enough to pick up.
Yeah, yeah. It's so I'm sure I would like it.
It's a nice design, got a nice visual style.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've heard nothing but good things about it. Like I said, there's no particular reason. I, you know, just haven't gotten around to it. I'm sure I will.
Yeah, it's on PC, Robert Middleton.
Okay.
Yeah, it's on PC. I think it's on Switch even, which is probably where I would play it. But yeah, it's on my list. I'm sure I'll get around to it.
Looks like there's a train missing.
Roguelite. Oh, does it upgrade? Can you upgrade your character between runs?
Yeah, you have upgrades that stay between.
Gotcha.
Runs.
So then it counts as a roguelite.
Yes.
That was my mistake. I said roguelike, and
people get very pedantic about that.
Listen, we finally solidified what we're calling a roguelike versus a roguelite. And I enjoy the solidification of our definitions, and so that was my fault. That was my bad, but I didn't know. I just didn't know. I'm so sorry.
All right. Got to develop a photo again.
Yep. Yeah, and Neko Re Nemo, I'm sorry you have lost the war. You can call a non-turn-based RPG a roguelike. It's out of our control. You can call it. The difference is whether or not you can upgrade your character between runs. And so something like Spelunky still counts as a roguelike. But something like Rogue Legacy is a Rogue Light, as you can upgrade your character between runs. You've lost the war. I applaud your valiant fighting for the definition, but I'm sorry for your loss. let's see here. Yeti Jack, what's your guy's opinion on some?
Three,
what?
Four,
oh, so you're
five.
You have to count. I'm sorry. What are you guys? What are some of your opinions on some people saying Soulsborne and Rogue like are poor genre names, and they don't really describe the genre without a reference to the progenitor game?
Well, it's like when we used to say Doom clone, I suppose.
Yeah.
Remember when every first-person shooter was a Doom clone?
Yeah. It's Half-Life just... was a Doom clone, right?
Yeah, it's just part of, you know, language.
Mm-hmm. Definitions change.
It'll stop being the name when someone comes up with a better name that sticks.
Yep.
That's the only time it will happen.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean,
and
what would you call a Souls-like, if not a Souls-like?
Exactly. Exactly. Right? We need to think that. Ooh, that could be a fun. That's a fun idea. That would take a little bit of writing. Like, I'd have to sit down and really think of it. That could be a good Slightly Civil War, where we just pitch names for genres that still have wibbly wobbly names.
I mean, that, when you think about it, all genre names are a bit wibbly wobbly.
Yeah.
I mean, action adventure. Everything is an action adventure. Simulation. Everything is a simulation.
Yes, exactly.
Survival game. Everything involves surviving in some way.
Some sort of survival, exactly.
Avoiding a failure state.
Role-playing game. Every game involves playing some sort of role. Absolutely. Exactly. Ooh, look at that demon guy.
Oh, it's time for bloody stealth stroke evasion sequences.
Are you all right?
Oh.
Where if you got to do it exactly right, or you get instantly killed and have to start again.
Ooh.
Well, and I guess that's my real, like, I agree with you, and that's my real thing as far as, like, roguelikes, roguelites, that sort of thing, where it's like, we have, the definitions are always wibbly, and we've kind of come to a group consensus, and we just kind of have to go with the group here. And that's all we can do. You know, we still call them Metroidvanias, even though really it's just a Metroid-like.
Well, I think Castlevania had some elements made it distinct from Metroid. Although, thinking about it, it's hard to pin down exactly what. I think Metroid was more about... Sorry, I'm focusing on running away from this hideous beast.
You just do that. Metroidvania is a dope-ass name, I agree with you. Which is why, like, that's what we... The hard part is coming up, like, first-person shooter, right? Like, it just rolls off the tongue. We don't need to call it a Doom clone anymore.
Yeah.
Because we found a name that describes what it is perfectly.
Yeah, one of the few genre names that is actually good and descriptive.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's from the first person, it's a shooter, bam.
Right. And yes, so, like...
The difference between Metroid and Vania... I think what it is that Metroid is more about locking mechanisms that involve a variety of keys. Like, use the gun to open this door, and I use this different gun to open this kind of door. Use
the double jump to get up to this ledge.
Well, that's the difference. I mean, Vania is more about using that sort of thing, which is more about using organic gameplay mechanics to allow you access new areas.
Although,
Metroid had double jumps as well, so maybe I'm talking out of my bum. Some people were saying that Vania was had more elements that were more in common with like RPGs. Like you had like stats and different equipable weapons and armor.
Right. But usually when we refer to a Metroidvania, we're just talking about unlocking new areas when you get new abilities. Which is, in my opinion, just a Metroid thing that Castlevania only latched on to later.
Well, yeah. But it was Castlevania Symphony of the Night when they started adding the Vania to Metroidvania, because Castlevania Symphony of the Night was such a classic game in the genre.
Okay. It all ends in me!
Bye then.
Okay. Souls like should be called rollers. Right? Like, we still haven't come up with a good name for Batman Arkham style combat.
Wish you could run a little faster. I tend to think of it as counter combat, because that's the usual distinguishing feature, is that there's a very prominent counter mechanic.
Oh, I like that. Counter combat. I've also heard it described as crowd combat, which I enjoyed.
Glaura mentions the term free-flow combat, which is another word I've heard used for it. But when you think about it, all combat is free-flow.
Right. It's that one specific, like, unblockable thing that you have to dodge and counter. Yeah. Counter combat, I think fits the bill.
Except it's specifically against groups of enemies as well.
That's the thing. That's specifically against crowds.
Yeah. Crowd counter combat.
Triple C.
Crowd countering.
Is this a Triple C game?
I don't know. It's more of a Triple X game.
Boom! X gonna give it to you. Heaven Oh Shame, thanks for the $5 American, who said, you certainly got snubbed with character action game, Yahtzee.
Yes. Because I think I've complained before that I came up with the term spectacle fighter to describe games like Bayonetta or Devil May Cry, where part of the mechanics is fighting in a spectacular way, not just fighting in a purely functional wear down the health until they're dead way. And those games are now generally termed character action games, which doesn't mean anything.
No, I much prefer Spectacle Fighter.
Because it's about the spectacle of fighting.
Right.
That's
it's
the point.
It's not just about the combat, it's about doing the combat with style.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like Mad World on the Wii.
Mm.
It was more about getting the most points from a kill and by killing them in an interesting way.
Yeah. What are you guys mad at me for? Are you guys mad at me for my knowledge of 90s hip-hop? I will not apologize for that.
What's annoying about the way this game works is it's not obvious what's a place you can go to and hide behind. And what the where the monster can see you.
Mmm. Mmm. I could see how that would be upsetting.
Also, I seem to be exclusively in the Realm of the Dead, so why am I not fading away like I do in other times this happens?
Because this is the part of the game where you have to do this.
Leg it.
You need some sort of like stretch out button that makes you run faster for a short period of time.
Yeah, push yourself. Take this seriously, woman.
Yeah. You know, stretch those hammies and move it. You can do it. Yeah, now I feel like I do want to spend a little bit of time over the weekend really trying to distill the Dark Souls formula to get a better name than a Souls-like or a Soulsborne.
Well, the problem is there's so many elements that make up a Souls-like formula. It's not just, you know, high difficulty.
Right.
Games where it's like when you die, all the enemies come back and you get back to a checkpoint.
Yes. High difficulty, respawning enemies.
Generally, it's an open world, Metroidvania style layout.
Yep.
It's about exploration and finding routes and generally
and having RPG elements, different character builds. Oh yeah, no, there's a whole lot to it, but I just
fights.
Basically I think I can do it. I think I can do it is all I'm saying. You know, I'm going to get a cork board and a big list of all the things in all of the games that are similar and start whittling it down.
Hyperazzi points out Sekiro doesn't have RPG elements.
That's right. That's why it's not a Souls-like.
Well, it is.
No, it's not. It doesn't have RPG elements. It doesn't have world exploration. It's very linear.
I invite you now to go onto your gaming forum of choice and announce your discovery that Sekiro is not a Souls-like and see what kind of response you get.
I have said this from the very beginning and I will not take it back now. It is... you cannot customize your build. It has no RPG elements. It does not have exploration elements.
Well, it does.
Well, not to the same extent.
As much as, say, Dark Souls 2, I'd say.
Sure. Which is the lesser of the Dark Souls.
All right. Still a Souls-like, though.
Still. I guess. I don't know. Yeah, to me, the thing that makes a Souls-like, well, I get to me the thing that makes a Souls game a Souls game, not a Souls-like, right? Because like Sekiro has Souls-like elements, so Sekiro is a Souls-like, but it's not a Souls game, is what I'm specifically saying. If this makes any sense.
Is Bloodborne a Souls-like?
Yeah, or Bloodborne is a Souls game because you can customize your character. I woke up with ice. You can replay the game with drastically different builds. I wanted nothing but to get out. Different weapons, different ways to play the game. You cannot do that with Sekiro, therefore it is not a Souls game. We can consider it a Souls-like because of the high difficulty, because of the respawning enemies, because of the slightly sprawling levels.
So I was wondering if there's any point to this sort of semantic argument at all.
No, it's all bullshit, but that's literally our job. So.
Oh, shit. Little glimpse behind the curtain there.
Our job is to be pedantic dickheads, Yahtzee. So, I'm just, it's a thing that I feel like being pedantic about. A Soulsy. Ooh, a Soulsy. I like a Soulsy. What was that thing? Sekiro is a Souls-like, not a Souls-born. Ooh, I like that, Billy Wilbo. Yes.
Why don't we just say that Dark Souls was an open-world RPG? Can we just do that?
It kind of is, right? I'm looking for is named Thomas. Kind of is. Who's Richard? So is Monster Hunter a Souls? I actually don't know. I'm sorry.
I wouldn't say so. It doesn't really have that Metroidvania style design with the exploration and unlocking of new areas.
I see a lot of people are getting into the semantics about like if Dark Souls and Bloodborne are Souls like, then Sekiro is a Souls light.
Back to this shit.
So sorry, everyone. Here, I can change the subject. Do you know what I have in front of me right now, Yahtzee?
That flashlight isn't an armor-like, it's an armor-light.
Do you know the things I have in front of me currently?
Besides the dog.
The dog is next to me. In front of me, I have Waterworld comic books. Did you know these existed?
No, but I can honestly say it doesn't surprise me in the least to know that they did.
After the movie, Acclaim Comics, which is kind of an offshoot of Valiant, did a 4-issue run of Waterworld: Children of the Leviathan.
There's like comic books of everything. I mean, they'll try like a 4-issue trial for pretty much anything.
Yeah. Look at. Hopefully, people can see how awful some of the art is on this. I'll just hold this up.
What is going on with that person's arm?
Right? Look at how awful that is. Isn't that terrible?
Is that their arm, or are they holding on to another person's entirely separate arm?
Exactly. So a couple of years ago, we went to Universal Studios over in California, and where they still have the Waterworld stunt show to this day, a very popular attraction. And my wife, who's a big nerd like I am, we had a great time. The kids had a great time. And so later for my birthday, my wife got me all 4 issues of the Waterworld comic, and I recently read them. They're very fun.
Do you have an opinion on the original film?
I really enjoy it. I understand it's complete and utter schlock, but I am a huge fan of post-apocalyptic sci-fi.
Yeah, there's plenty of, like, not particularly good films that do really well. Mm. What turned into a flop often feels kind of arbitrary.
Yeah, I think I've distilled it, which is, like, the thing that made Waterworld flop was the casting of Kevin Costner.
You want to shovel it all on him, do you?
I do. I think I did a little looking into this because I was just on a podcast recently talking about the Waterworld comics. Kevin Costner produced Waterworld, so he got to star in it.
Cool.
I know he paid for the movie. That's why he got to star in it. And he should not have starred in it He started the movie when he was a little over 40 years old, so I think that Waterworld was Kevin Costner's midlife crisis.
Oh, it was his black tank top movie.
Yep. He's like, I'm done being the old Midwestern laid back mentor. I want to be an action star now. And guess what? He is not an action star.
Was not the same true of The Postman?
The Postman is a absurdly bad movie. But okay. We over at Red Letter Media often watch The Postman on a bad movie night because we try to unpack it and cannot. It's absurdly bad, but his character in The Postman isn't necessarily an action star. He's actually kind of like a schlub grifter.
Right.
And so his casting makes a ton of sense in that. It's just too long. It doesn't make any sense. It's just bad. It's very, very bad. Whereas Waterworld makes sense, has cool action sequences, is a neat world, is a sci-fi movie. The only problem is Kevin Costner shouldn't have been the big action hero star. If you replace him with like a younger, buff, handsome dude, like you got a real movie.
Like a Brendan Fraser at the time.
Ooh, like a Brendan. Well, not Brendan Fraser. You need someone. Okay, you want to know my dream casting? And I don't know how much this is gonna make sense to people. Hopefully, you've all seen Waterworld. You know who would be great as the Mariner in Waterworld?
Tell me.
Sigourney Weaver.
Interesting.
What you need is, you know, the Mariner is a loner, he's an outsider, and he's a badass. And then he's slow, like, so it needs to be someone with a lot of gravity to them, right? And someone who can handle action sequences. And if you've seen any of the later Aliens movies, you know that Sigourney Weaver kicks ass. And so, like, 90s Sigourney Weaver as the Mariner makes a ton of sense.
That's interesting. I always thought the appeal of Sigourney Weaver in the original Alien film was that she didn't really come across as an action sort of character. That she was like an every person thrown in over her head.
Oh, absolutely. Well, that was why Alien is my favorite of the Alien movies. Yes.
I would argue it's kind of the same thing in Aliens, at least until towards the end when she has her Bruce Campbell straps the chainsaw to the hand in Evil Dead 2 moment.
Yes, but then if you see the later Alien movies, she gets more action-y, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, definitely in Alien Resurrection.
Yes, yes. And I guess all I'm saying here is she has the gravity to pull off, like, distant loner. She has the action chops. And so she would make a ton of sense.
I don't know, though. Doesn't the Mariner have a sort of otherworldliness about them as well? I think Sigourney Weaver might be too human.
Ooh, maybe. Maybe.
That's just my instinct.
I think that's fair. I mean, we are talking about the same, you know, the same person who has played, you know, like the possessed person in Ghostbusters. Like, she has an otherworldliness to her. Sorry, go ahead.
I don't know, I think kind of the joke in Ghostbusters was that she was still a sort of normal person with this otherworldly voice speaking through them.
Yeah, maybe. I think, like, if we were going modern casting, someone like Sebastian Shaw, who plays the Winter Soldier.
Right.
You know, like, definitely, like, distant, regal, weird looking, but, like, you know, can still handle himself in an action scene. Same with Michael B. Jordan. But also, you could cast Michael B. Jordan in anything.
All right.
Great.
Here's a thought.
Oh, sorry. Sebastian Stan. Oh, did I call him? It's not Sebastian Shaw. Whoopsie. Sorry, go ahead. Yeah, it's your thought.
Here's an out-of-nowhere thought for a person, alternative person to play the Mariner.
Okay.
Cillian Murphy.
Let me look up who that is.
He was the lead in 28 Days Later, and he played Scarecrow in Batman Begins.
Ooh, interesting.
Because he's done, like, lead hero in 28 Days Later, but he's also got that otherworldly element.
Yes, very distant, very, like, outsider. The question for Cillian Murphy is, does he have the ability, like, can you warm up to him?
I'd say so. He's in Peaky Blinders.
That's
like a sort of working class hero, as I understand it.
Okay.
I haven't seen Peaky Blinders. I'm just going off like promotional art there.
Yeah. He was a scarecrow in the Batman movies. Yeah, he definitely has that like air about him, that like presence, which to me Kevin Costner does not have.
Yes.
I don't believe Kevin Costner as like a loner hermit who doesn't talk to people.
Right.
You know.
He's somebody's dad.
Yeah. He's Kevin Costner. Yes, he's somebody's dad. Exactly. And so I feel like he turned 40. He was over 40, and he wanted to be in an action movie. So he financed an action movie and cast himself in the lead. But I still love it. I love Waterworld. Behind me is my like Blu-ray special edition of Waterworld that has all three cuts to the movie, including the super like 180 minute cut.
Three tries, and they still couldn't get it to work.
Right. Yeah. So, in any case, Waterworld comic series. The story in the comics, by the way, not that bad. Not that bad. Some of the art, very bad.
Okay then.
But the story is not that bad. Like Tom Hardy was Mad Men. Yeah, Tom Hardy like also would make a great Mariner. He like, because obviously like Mariner is just Mad Max, so
yeah. I feel like Tom Hardy would fit into a lot of roles.
Yeah, Tom Hardy's just good in a lot of things.
He's got that sort of liquid quality where he can just form the shape of whatever vessel you put him in.
I'm with you 100%. I feel very similarly about Michael B. Jordan, specifically in action heavy roles where it's like, yeah, just put him anywhere, he'll be great.
I'm really not engaged with this game because it's 3:00.
Oh, great. Yeah, I mean, we have been talking about Waterworld for the past 20 minutes.
And we're standing in a swimming pool. That's kind of relevant. Well, thanks for watching the first CP stream. We've been playing The Medium, the new game by Bloober Team, where they were trying to get away from their horror walking simulator thing and didn't fully succeed.
Well, there you go. So everyone, make sure to watch Waterworld.
Yes, we also learned Jack has a lot of opinions on a 90s flop movie that none of you kids have heard of.
Everybody cares about Waterworld.
Well, there's a lot of Hollywood accountants that care about it, I know.
That's very true.
All right. Yeah.
Thanks for watching, everybody. Make sure to come back tomorrow at this time from Central Time from 3 to 5, same time. Nick and I will be streaming more Dark Souls 3, I believe, as I'm making my way through that game on stream with all the DLC, so that'll be a lot of fun.
Fun. And if it wasn't clear, this was the stream that comes after Zero Punctuation. If you haven't seen this week's Zero Punctuation on The Medium, go to escapismagazine.com and you can watch it there. If you have some kind of grudge against the escapist side, you'll have to wait a week for it to come out on YouTube, I'm afraid.
The post CP stream. I got it mixed up.
I might have noticed the enormous logo under your head right there.
I thought it was the Waterworld Hour.
And remember to follow us on Twitter. I'm at Yahtzee Croshaw. Jack is at Harlack. That's all under our foces right there. You can follow the escapist on at Escapist Magazine or Zero Punctuation on at Z-Punctuation. And I will see you next week for the next Zero Punctuation. I think that's everything. Buy my books.
Yeah, buy his books. They're great.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Broadcast now. Bye.